Hey YouTube, it's Dimitri, and today we're going to talk about what to do if you don't have a quant degree, so you have a finance background, or what do you do if you don't have like a financial engineering degree, but you have like a PhD in something quantitative, but more or less unrelated, and kind of how do you patch these things together, how do you make a career out of it, what are they worth, kind of how do you transition, a lot of those questions in general, but let's just dive on in. All right, so let's just start off with my story here. For those of you that don't know me or you don't know my background, or you haven't looked at my LinkedIn or whatever, I come from a finance background from a mediocre state school. I went to Washington State University and I loved it. Go Cougs. But that being said, if you're in that situation where you have an undergrad degree in finance, you're wanting to get into like quantitative finance, right? You've discovered it most likely too late. Like you went through the four-year degree, if you're like me, and you discovered quantitative finance like your last semester, you're screwed, okay? I'm just gonna lay that out for you right there. You're in a situation where you want a job in an industry that you have no experience in. So let me make that blatantly clear. A finance degree does not qualify you to do anything in quantitative finance, okay? So I'm already in that situation. I looked through all my options, and I know a lot of you have a similar situation where like you start reaching out to all these people in the industry and they have quantitative finance backgrounds. I'm looking for some help, some tips. Nobody will help you, at least when I did it. Nobody was out there. Nobody was willing to tell you anything. I had to actually go to the business side of things, given I had a business degree, and talk to a bunch of people on that side, but it wasn't really the same as getting quantitative finance advice. And so it's hard to get going and get legitimate advice in that situation. But I kind of figured out from talking to a lot of different people, professionals, friends of friends, kind of hearing things, you know, watching documentaries, doing research and all that, you really needed something that was very mathematical. So I looked at financial engineering as an option. That was the route I ended up taking. So I applied my first year right after undergrad, and I only applied to the five schools that I wanted to go to. They were all engineering programs. Some of them don't even exist anymore. But they were the top of the top. For example, I really, really wanted to go to Columbia, and I wanted to work underneath Emmanuel Derman because of his reputation, the books I had read. I felt he could train me better than anybody else. But it was more or less that I know I needed to switch from finance and business, and I had to make a drastic change to do that. My first year, I didn't get into those top five schools. No surprise. I literally don't blame any of the programs. I would have been a huge risk, and I didn't have any of the academic background to do that. So I took a year off, and I worked. So I worked all of undergrad. I just continued working after undergrad, and I studied a lot. So I went and I studied and I studied and I studied. All this studying is going to do nothing for you on the applications. Nobody cares, okay? Nobody cares that you self-studied. Nobody cares that you took Coursera. Nobody cares that you have a free online degree. Nobody cares about any of that. You need to do the studying for the aspect that you know you're behind. So the students that are actually going from undergrads into like financial engineering masters, for example, they already have a four-year undergrad degree in mathematics, or they have a four-year undergrad degree in engineering. So in the US, what does that translate into? 2 years of generals and 2 years of specialty. So you need 2 years of mathematics or 2 years of engineering somehow to catch up. Okay, there's going to be all these concepts you just don't know that you need to catch up on. And doing that studying is going to prepare you for the work if you get into these programs, okay? So I took this bet, basically. I studied because I enjoyed the math, I enjoyed the statistics, I enjoyed programming, for example. I was already doing a bunch of programming in my day job, but at the same time, I really, really wanted to work in quantitative finance. And so I studied just to catch up, okay? It's not going to help you with grad school. It's not going to help you with getting your first job. But educationally, academically, you'll do much better. And then when you get your first job, you'll actually perform better because you know what you're doing. But you need to do that in that period. So, I mean, if you have a semester or two left and you have a finance degree, you're already so far in, right? Just finish it. But you need to be studying or taking electives that are math-based to really prepare you for that master's. So after I did all this studying and catching up, you know, as much as possible academically, and I wish I would have had some of the books I know about now, which I've talked about in other videos, but catching up is a crucial portion just to kind of well-round you and so that you'll be better prepared if you do get into a master's program. So my second year, I reapplied. I got into two different programs in financial engineering. I chose to go to the University of Michigan, and that was the route. That was basically the ticket I needed to get into quantitative finance. If you can do the jump, right? So if you can go from a business background to a master's in financial engineering, it's worth it if you do the studying in the middle. Today, it should be even easier to go from a finance degree to a financial engineering degree because most of these programs are actually ran in business schools. I've worked with some of the admissions offices at some of these universities. I've talked to them about helping their programs. I've talked to their program directors about doing different activities with different universities. I haven't done a lot of work with them for a variety of personal reasons. But at the end of the day, a lot of these business programs are looking for a wide variety of students. They do want the engineers, some math students. They also want some finance students and some business background students. So that might be an option, but as you know, I don't really call it a real financial engineering degree. And part of that is just because the lack of rigor in some of these programs. Again, it's my personal opinion, but this might be a great option for you. You might be able to go from a finance degree to a business financial engineering degree. And then if you continue your self-learning, you might be able to take that and leverage that into a great opportunity as a quant. Yes, these business programs, which are like the dominant financial engineering types of programs out there now, there's so many of them, that yeah, you can take that and you could leverage that into an actual quantitative finance role. But that's one path that you can take. Okay, so go from finance undergrad, do a bunch of studying, I highly encourage that, and then go into a financial engineering degree that is based in a business school because they will be more understanding of your business background. That's not the route I took. I ended up going into the University of Michigan. It was housed in the engineering department. It was engineering driven. All of our classes were mainly taken from the math and engineering departments for the core, I would say, quantitative classes. And then we did take a few classes from Ross Business School, you know, some general finance, getting financial theory down, seeing kind of how the industry works. I think it was a good combination in itself. I ended up not finishing that program because they canceled our degree. And second of all, I felt like the educational component of it, the focus on the academic side wasn't there for a variety of reasons. There was a lot of focus to get job placement, which I understand. But at the same time, that wasn't the best fit for me. But what ended up happening is they closed that financial engineering program. I was able to finish it if I wanted to, or I could transfer. So instead of sticking with a program that was dying, I ended up transferring into a MAE program, so a Master's of Applied Economics. And then you have a specialization. So mine is a Master's of Applied Economics in financial engineering because most of my electives were actually financial engineering and statistics based, which means I focused solely around doing quantitative finance as a whole. So what does that mean a little bit here? If you have the option to take another degree or you get a master's degree or a PhD, financial engineering in itself is only financial engineering. That's engineering derivative products, okay? If you want to do quantitative finance as a whole, like work in risk management or you know do quantitative research, a lot of times the classes you would need, the academic training, the education, might be outside of those core courses of like stochastic calculus, for example. You wanted to take a lot of econometrics courses. So yes, you can take a econometrics course, but you might want to take two or three econometrics courses. You might want to take more economics that's applied to specific situations, for example. You might want to take more highly advanced, like for example, PhD level statistics courses, because they're going to focus more on topics that you would use in a risk management setting. So my path's a little different. Again, you can take a similar path to mine, which was I went from finance to financial engineering. I looked at it, I evaluated it. I didn't really like a lot of the aspects of the program that I got into. So I ended up switching and going into applied economics with a big opportunity to take electives, and then you can take the electives you need. Do not waste your electives on stupid things like public policy if you want to work in quantitative finance. Take statistics, take mathematics, take computer science. Those are going to be the classes that are going to get you the job. All right, so that's kind of the general path I'd recommend for a finance degree. Maybe taking the softer financial engineering side. You can take other routes though, and this is what's going to dive into the other question I've been getting on YouTube here. Basically, someone's been asking quite a bit here, what happens if you end up with like a quantitative PhD? So something like theoretical physics, theoretical computer science, pure mathematics, etc. And whether a PhD makes any difference at all compared to, you know, a master's and whatnot. So let's talk about not related degrees, as we're going to call them here. So first off, financial engineering degrees are great if you want to do engineering of financial products. but kind of, but not really. So the master's degrees are great. You can do a lot with the master's to get you jump-started. So if you want to get involved in actually engineering exotic derivative products, or you want to do, for example, quantitative research at like Two Sigmas, a lot of these companies require a PhD. There's not really a lot of PhDs in financial engineering. So what ends up happening is most of the guys working in these realms actually do have these PhDs in weird, kind of related, kind of unrelated topics, like mentioned in the question. You might end up having a PhD in, you know, theoretical physics, theoretical computer science, pure mathematics. Like, these areas are going to be more or less what you're going to use to do research. If you want to be engineering exotic derivative products, usually these come from very, very heavy math backgrounds. Math backgrounds that have spent more than your little one or two classes on stochastic calculus. It's going to be people that are like very heavily into theoretical or even pure mathematics, or applied mathematics, I guess, because what you need to do this is a very, very deep mathematical understanding theoretically, but also being able to apply this in an applied setting. To do this, PhDs have so much more training, so much more experience doing research within itself, which is why a lot of these firms prefer to have a PhD for doing research. Again, doing exotic options, you need a lot more mathematics to actually engineer derivative products that are exotics or different from what we're typically used to doing. So to do that, you need more than a master's in financial engineering typically, especially if you're not one of the top very rigorous financial engineering programs, and a lot of them don't cover the math as heavy. So again, it's just focus and points here. So if you're focusing more on like computer science or more on data science or more on, you know, I don't know, risk management, for example, and statistics, you're not going to cover the amount of mathematics needed to do a lot of the engineering side of derivatives. So a PhD in general can be used. That's an alternative route. As I've mentioned, right, I have a master's of applied economics in financial engineering. Again, when I tell people, I usually just tell you it's a master's of applied economics. I don't really care. I worked with a lot of guys that have PhD in statistics. I worked with guys that have master's in statistics, for example. The key with all these alternative degrees is when we're hiring for a position, so say in risk management, or you're hiring in, you know, a trading firm, doing research or doing something else, quantitative finance is basically skill driven. So I want to know that you have the skills I need to do the job, but I also want the rigor kind of benchmark. So for example, we do require the master's and the PhDs. We do prefer non-online degrees. We do prefer top-ranked programs, or at least generally well-known programs, all for the fact that we just want that bare minimum benchmark that, okay, you have the background, you have the education, you've done the work. But realistically, what you learn, right, even with a PhD, for example, is just the minimum. We really need you to take that to the next level in the industry. We need you to take it. We need you to run with it. We need you to be excited with it. You need to learn a lot, guys. I've learned a ton working in the industry, a lot more and a lot further than I did with my master's. Those are just the minimum requirements to really get you going. But the key to getting the job, again, so back to this, is skill-based, is I want to see a resume that's tailored to what I'm hiring for. So if I'm hiring for, I don't know, a data science and data research position in quantitative finance, so say it's a trading firm and we're going to be exploring machine learning and AI, I want someone that has the background of AI and machine learning at a math and statistics level. I want to see that on their resume. So when you come from these alternative backgrounds, we're happy to have you. And a lot of quantitative finance professionals, probably the vast majority, do not have financial engineering degrees. They come from physics, economics, econometrics kind of area, statistics, mathematics, pure mathematics, applied mathematics, right? They're coming from different areas. And the key on breaking in for these is that you need to show that you have a very, very rigorous and deep background, which we really, really like. We get excited about it. But we want to see a resume that's tailored to what we're looking for, right? So I'm not going to go out and say, oh, I want a master's in physics or a PhD in physics, and I want it to be astrophysics, and I don't know, putting something ridiculous on this, and then going and looking for that candidate. I'm just going to put the job posting out there and see what comes in. I want people that are excited, but that also have a background in doing what they can do. Because just having a PhD, for example, in physics isn't enough. You really need the drive, the motivation, the excitement. You need the education and the skills behind it. You need to be able to see how things are going to be applied. One of the biggest mistakes I do see is people do hire PhDs in different areas. And then a lot of times, since they don't have the excitement towards finance and quantitative finance, they end up not fitting and not working out real well. And then career-wise, they don't do very well, and they can't figure out why. It's just because you don't have the drive and excitement and application towards quantitative finance. So kind of summarize this whole video up here. If you have a finance background, you're in a tough spot, okay? You don't have the math. You're going to need at least the 2 years of mathematical education from your undergrad, and then you can apply to master's. If you have a undergrad and a master's already in finance, or an MBA, for example, you're in a really, really tough spot because the bare minimum ticket to get into this is there going to be that STEM master's or PhD to really get in. Yes, there are people who come from these backgrounds that have leveraged themselves, networked, and worked in really interesting ways to get into quantitative finance. However, they've learned the skills and materials along the way. But I do not recommend taking that route if you don't have to. If you already have the finance degree, try to get as much education and training on the side as you can. Study, do well like on your GREs and your statement of purpose. But in general, find something that interests you. So I actually don't recommend financial engineering programs a lot. The reason being is because if you want to end up like in, I don't know, model implementation, and you want to do like algorithmic trading, and you want to focus on speed of execution, you're better off with a computer science degree. If you want to work in risk management, for example, you're better off with a statistics degree. If you want to end up in like quantitative research, you're better off with a PhD in like applied mathematics, for example. If physics excites you, that's another option, though it's kind of challenging, I think, to break from physics to quantitative finance. But find something that interests you. Look for the skill sets in quantitative finance. So go through my videos and see what I'm talking about. And then try to match up a degree with this and then work on networking, writing a well-written resume that has all the skills and kind of interests and backgrounds, and then put that together, and that's how you can really break in. So that applies both to the finance side and to the PhD side. But just in general, skills is one of the biggest things. There is no shortcut around the master's and PhD. I know it sucks. I had the finance undergrad. I spent, you know, $70,000 for my master's. It took me 2 years, right? It's an investment in time and money and education. But if you really enjoy it, it's worth the effort. If you're looking for the best way to make a lot of money, and you already have a finance background, to optimize your outcome, get an MBA. They make really good money. If you get into a good MBA program, you can end up in a high management position. That's another route. And then kind of to conclude all this in general is looking at your goals. If you are in finance and you like doing equity research, and for some reason you're convinced you want to do high-end analytics, you can do that in a traditional finance firm and not have to do quantitative finance necessarily. So traditional finance firms typically work more in Excel and SQL, for example. Quants typically work in like C++, SAS, R, Python. But again, if you're in a position where you just love finance and you just want to make some good money, but you're also interested, there's nothing that says you have to go and get that degree and have to get that specific job. You can always learn things online, for example, read books and apply them to your current job and kind of leverage them. That's kind of an alternative route into quantitative finance. Sometimes it just happens that you apply things, you learn a lot, and then you get there. But really, without the master's and PhD on the resume, it makes it very, very challenging to switch jobs, even if you're really good at what you do in a current quantitative finance role. So anyways, I hope you found that helpful. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And as always, until next time.